Good morning and welcome to the 24th meeting of 2023 with the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business this morning is a decision to take items 5, 6 and 8 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. We'll now move to our next item of business, and this is our third evidence session on the Bankruptcy and Diligence Scotland Bill at Stage 1. Today we will hear from creditors. So I welcome Andrew Fraser, President, and Roderick McPherson, Honorary Secretary, Society of Messenger at Arms and Sheriff Officers. And I also welcome Cheryl Hind, Council Revenues Manager, and Elizabeth McCrossan, Senior Transactions Officer, City of Edinburgh Council. Just to let you know, the questions will be directed to your organisation, and if you can decide among you who will be answering the question, that would be helpful. Can I maybe start with one of the proposals in the bill, which is to require banks and others who are subject to arrestment requests to provide information about why arrestment has been made unsuccessful. Now, we have heard some evidence from banks who say this would be too onerous a duty to place on them, but I wonder if Edinburgh City Council could first of all say if they would find this information helpful, if it was a requirement for banks to share when it has been unsuccessful.
Yeah, thank you. From an efficiency of process point of view, I know having listened some to the evidence from previous committees, at the moment we don't know if a customer is actually with a particular bank, and they could maybe have an order sent to them and it's not even their customer. So if we were aware when an order failed that it was because they weren't their customer, it would allow our debt partners to streamline their process. At present, what they actually use is almost like an algorithm. Knowledge of the local area and what banks and customers in these particular areas tend to use. So it's built up over time. From my point of view, it would probably be more efficient because you're asking the appropriate bank. And also the other side of the coin would be if you know an arrestment has failed because there are no funds in the bank, then it also would streamline the process. And when the knowledge is built up over time, it's only the banks that we know that those customers are actually members of that will be asked, not three or four different banks.
The banks have talked about, so would the local authorities tend to put in a lot of requests at the same time? They've kind of talked about the volume this would create because they get kind of bulk applications, or is that?
So we use a debt partner who would do the arrestments on our behalf, and it's their knowledge that I was speaking about at the start, that they would know that a particular part of Scotland, for instance, tends to use a particular bank. And that would be the first bank that they would request the monies from. So I don't know if that answers.
So that's helpful. And just as a supplementary question to that, is it a successful process to go through? So this is the way in which, you know, it goes to a collection agency.
Yes.
Is this route, or are you dealing with people who have resources in the bank? Is it a useful tool to be using? Is it successful, or is
it is like our partner chooses which form of diligence is most appropriate for a particular customer. Obviously, the levels of earnings in the bank has increased, so that in itself helps protect the debtor. So knowing that someone doesn't have the funds, it would mean that you wouldn't keep asking the same question and perhaps use a different diligence route to engage with those customers. But to be clear, for us, it takes a lot of engagement before we would actually pass a case to our debt partners. So early engagement is always the first point for us, and making sure that our citizens have access to assistance to be able to help them with their debt before it does get to that stage. So it is quite far down in the process before we would actually pass information to our debt partners.
Okay, thank you. Can I come to our other witnesses? Would this suggestion, I mean, do you have any views on what this proposal would result in? Would it lead to additional costs, or do you have any concerns about this proposal?
Convener, first of all, can I thank you for inviting the Society of Messengers at Arms and Sheriff Officers. You introduced us as representing creditors, but we don't. We are the officers of court, and we have a huge experience of creditors, large creditors, and party litigants who come to the offices of our members wanting to have documents served or decrees enforced. And some of our members work very closely with councils, such as are here represented, but we don't represent creditors.
So that's an accurate description. But yeah.
Thank you. And we are also very grateful, and perhaps I had wanted to tell you that I might have been one of the small number of people, I suppose they would be, who had given evidence in front of a Scottish parliamentary committee in two different centuries. So thank you for inviting us for a very long time. But what I've discovered by looking at my 25-year diary is that I actually turned up on the 11th of January in the year 2000. But we're very grateful as a society for the involvement that we've had from the very earliest days of the Scottish Parliament. The work of the Bankruptcy and Diligence, etc., Scotland Act of 2007 created a revolution in the law of arrestment. Before, arrestment was an inchoate diligence. It didn't of itself transfer the arrested fund from a debtor to a creditor, but the work of the Parliament created what many of us think to have been a huge step forward in allowing for the automatic transfer of arrested funds through arrestment. One of the things that is lacking from the changes that were made in 2007 to the primary statute, the 1987 Debtors Scotland Act, is that whilst arrestees, usually banks, have to let the arrester, the creditor, know within 3 weeks how much has been arrested, they don't have to tell them if nothing has been arrested. And of course, from a creditor's point of view, it's they want to know what has been the outcome of that particular arrestment. Now, what an officer of court will tell them at the moment is, if you haven't heard within 3 weeks, nothing has been arrested. But I think many creditors would prefer to be told that nothing has been arrested and would prefer to get as much information as the law provides for the arrestee to disclose in these specially privileged circumstances of an arrestment being served lawfully.
Thank you. I'll now move on to Colin Beattie to be followed by Myrtle Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. The debt advice and information package is a key tool for communication with debtors. Other ways that its use could be improved. Maybe, Cheryl, I can ask you firstly.
I mentioned at the start about early engagement. For us, it's about collaboration with as many agencies as possible, including our own advice shop, and making the website as accessible as possible with information that will arm people with what they can do should certain things happen. Most of our communications that go out, whether it be via email or letter, have links to these support mechanisms for citizens. Our advice shop, the one that's within the council, and also colleagues within the Citizens Advice Board, Bureau, they also have links into the information that we have to support citizens. So in addition to the debt advice pack, which would be provided to people, early engagement will mean that they get access to as much information as possible, including is there a benefit that they could potentially access, or are there reliefs and exemptions that they are not claiming that they could be due. So assisting people before it gets to the stage where it is overwhelming is the key message for us, and making sure that everybody speaks to each other to get the best for citizens.
I suppose we're really looking at where there are gaps in that information flow. Where do you see the gaps? How could this be improved?
I guess the gaps could possibly be if someone hasn't, they're not in the place to be able to speak to someone, and we're talking about early engagement, and they're not in a place to be able to engage. Part of the bill is to do with the moratorium, and I guess it's talking to other agencies and making sure that whilst they do have a particular professional role in this, it's also signposting folks to help at early stages. So for me, it's all about education and making sure that we actually all have as much information as possible to assist citizens.
Just so I can get in my own head the sort of dimensions we're talking about here, how many arrestments do you deal with in a year? Just roughly.
Probably need to get the information direct from our debt partner, but it's very low numbers. Certainly, they did a piece of work for us when the levels changed from the 500 and upwards to see what the implication would be, but it's not the first action that they would go to. So I think you're talking low percentages of our caseload that would be a bank arrestment.
Rorick, I don't know if you want to comment on this. Or...
Thank you. Or perhaps, if I should suggest that Andy would. Yes.
Excuse me. Thank you. I think first and foremost, the debt advice pack itself has to be improved. The information contained in it, trying to get people to read, although it is to you or I possibly a small leaflet, getting people that are in debt to read and make use of the information in it, I think is a challenge in itself. I think we would support absolutely people receiving debt advice packs at the outset of a court action. Many times they only receive it after decree has been granted, the die has been cast, as it were, and they're in a state where they're possibly not in a good state of mind to deal with it. I think at the start of an action, having all the information would be much more useful to them.
I mean, you're talking about not being a big thing to read, but people have a block against actually reading it. Is there a way past that?
That's above my pay grade, I would say. That's for somebody that needs to... It's my opinion, and the opinion of many officers of court, that the advice pack itself has to be improved, has to be more concise.
You say more concise. I mean, you were talking about a fairly modest leaflet a few minutes ago.
It is.
But how can we make it more concise?
I don't have an answer for you in that respect, but getting in the real world, getting people to read something like that is sometimes a challenge.
So in your experience, this has been a recurring problem?
Yes.
Interesting. Okay. Let me just move on to something else. The Scottish Government intends to use regulations to introduce information disclosure orders and add inhibitions to the options available under summary warrant. Firstly, do you support the introduction of information disclosure orders, and if so, how will they improve the diligence landscape for creditors? And Cheryl, maybe I can come back to you on that one.
The inhibition obviously is one method of being able to secure funds. I guess the detail of that particular answer, Elizabeth, who is one of the technical people within the team, had gone into some detail because she does have a law degree as well. So I'm obviously very impressed with the fact that she knows more about the bill and the inhibition. Do you want to maybe comment on that?
I can't speak to the policy journey behind this bill. What I can speak to is the customer-facing interactions that I have on a day-to-day basis with our customers. And I know we've moved on from the DAIP pack, but just if I could just add something to that. I noticed it's only a 16-page document, but there is nowhere mentioned in this document or pamphlet how a person would go about applying for a moratorium. It doesn't alert them to the fact that there exists a moratorium currently. It's only mentioned briefly on page 15 of the pamphlet, and I think that's something that could certainly be improved upon in the wording of that pamphlet. So, putting that aside, as far as obtaining a certificate of resources, I think that would be very useful to creditors. Although we do have some measures in place already when we conduct due diligence before deciding what action to take against a debtor, we have resources such as the Registers of Scotland. We have the credit agency reports that we can access. They're not always very thorough in terms of actually telling us how much somebody has in their bank account. And that might certainly be useful because that can be relayed to our sheriff officer partners before they even consider doing a bank arrestment, for example. Why go to the cost of conducting a bank arrestment if there's no money in the bank account? If we know that information ahead of time, that could be very useful. But I'm just a little bit concerned about sort of privacy issues. If a creditor or anybody has a right to go and ask how much does that person have in their bank account, could they not raise objections in terms of, well, that really is a breach of my human rights, my right to privacy and all of that. So it's a good idea. It would be useful for creditors. I don't think debtors would like it very much.
Can I maybe ask our sheriff officers if they've got a...
Thank you. Okay, the disclosure of information is the biggest improvement possible in the work of the Parliament so far as the effective use of diligence is concerned. It was part 16 of the 2007 Act. It was enacted that there would be a system for the disclosure of information in circumstances where parties who had gone to court and had obtained their decrees wanted information that would allow them to enforce their decrees or their documents of debt. And since 2007, no system has ever been commenced for the disclosure of information. I mentioned that we are not the creditors' agents. Officers of court are neutral between the parties. But when a party litigant comes to our office and says, I have been to court, I have gone through every step in the procedure, and the sheriff says I am entitled to be paid this, and now you're telling me that because I don't know where my debtor has a bank account, because the debtor doesn't own a house, because the debtor isn't carrying on business and has business assets, there's nothing that you can do at the moment to enforce my decree. And from that point of view, I can certainly say there is a great longing for a system of disclosure of information, because in the old days, when there were only the clearing banks, if people wanted to be able to carry out a bank arrestment, they would ask the sheriff officer to arrest with the main banks. Now, there are so many banks, it's impossible to think that people would pay for all those different fees for arresting with different banks. It depends upon the quality of the information whether a creditor who has obtained a decree is going to be successful or not. That's if the debtor doesn't choose and voluntarily makes payment. So to have a system for the controlled access to information about where bank accounts are maintained would be a, a fundamental step taken by the Parliament in allowing for the precise enforcement of decrees.
Just one last brief question. What impact will the addition of inhibition to the summary warrant options have? Do you think it will make things better or worse for debtors who own their home? Cheryl, I'm coming back to you.
That's okay. At the moment, what we see is, obviously, we've got inhibitions in place, and we do remind citizens that these are in place because they can choose to pay funds at any stage. What you do have is possibly people not paying until they're leaving a home in some sad circumstances because someone's actually died, and that's when the asset is sold. So it's a long extracted period of time, and for me it's about supporting a person to be able to continue to pay for services, etc. It is, as I say, a long time between you lodging the inhibition and then renewing it, but then annually reminding them the person is not, they don't need to pay until the asset's sold. So it is, on balance, you know that there will be funds there, but for councils, certainly for collecting monies for services, it's a balance, because if we don't collect funds, then we can't provide other services like bin collections and stuff like that. So it is making sure that you've got the right balance between appropriate diligence action and collection. So inhibitions, they do serve a purpose, but they are not, you know, the catch-all for everything if someone owns their home. Elizabeth?
Yes. I'm personally not very happy with the idea of an inhibition being sought just on the back of a warranted account. Now, I don't have statistics to hand, but we have many thousands, I'm quite sure, accounts which are currently at the stage of warrant and which have been passed to sheriff officers for collection. There is seeking an inhibition is like a next step forward. It's usually a warrant that's given in within the wording of the decree itself that's awarded to the creditor. And that our usual practice is once we have decree, we immediately look to obtaining an inhibition. But there's no point in doing that if the person doesn't own any heritable property. To allow, say, our sheriff officers to make that decision, there would be a huge cost if they were then charged with trying to find out if this debtor does actually own heritable property that an inhibition would have an effect upon. I just feel the warrant stage is a little bit too early in the process for that to happen. It is quite an advanced type of diligence, which we only enter into that after, as I've mentioned before, due diligence. We check things such as what is the makeup of the household, are there young children in the home, for example. Would we want to perhaps, we wouldn't want to encourage somebody to perhaps sell their property in order to settle their debt necessarily, but with an inhibition in place, it acts as a form of security in a way. So if the person is financially able to move, say, to a smaller property, that inhibition would still have effect, because it's a personal diligence that applies to the individual person and not to the property that they currently live in. But I'm quite actively involved in obtaining inhibitions, but I just feel doing it on the back of a warrant is just a little bit too early in the process, because there are other interventions that can happen before we get to the stage of seeking an inhibition.
Perhaps I can ask our sheriff officers if they've got a view.
Sure. First of all, you don't require a specific warrant to serve an inhibition. It can be served in any ex officio decree. These aren't used randomly, and Elizabeth's quite correct that they wouldn't be used in a lot of cases. A lot of people that owe council tax may be council tenants, don't own any heritable property. However, it's a further way to seek the security over the debt. And I think it would be supported across our profession as another option, given how limited our powers are at the moment. If I may come back to the question of information disclosure orders, would that be just to add in something Roddy mentioned? We have reached a position with the powers that we have at the moment where there's no longer access to justice for creditors. This has become more and more apparent given the implementation of the simple procedure rules, where more and more party litigants are raising their own court actions. They no longer have a solicitor guiding them. They often don't seek any help from money advice, citizen advice. They go through the courts, they arrive at our doors. We go through the process, help them as much as we can, which I can assure you is extremely time consuming, dealing with somebody that has no idea or perception of legal process. We're the first people that tell them, as Roddy says, without a bank account, without employment details, we can't recover your debt. Walk a mile in another man's shoes, put yourself in that position. If you're looking for, you have a decree against somebody, we've reached a stage in this country without information disclosure orders where decrees from our courts are unenforceable because of lack of information. We would hope that if information disclosure orders are brought forward, the next step has to be for HMRC to be accountable to obtain employment details for people. There's no other country in Europe, as far as we are aware, where a court decree after a hearing is unenforceable.
Thank you for that.
Murdo Fraser to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'd like to ask about other aspects of reform. It's a very narrowly focused bill, this, so there are issues that are perhaps not covered by the bill that we've heard raised by other witnesses. And specifically, we've heard calls in relation to the minimal asset process bankruptcy, where at the moment individuals can only apply for this once every 10 years. And we've heard some calls that that period should be reduced perhaps to 5 years, or the time limit removed altogether. And I'm interested if anybody has any particular view on that as a potential addition to the bill. If you have no view on it, that's absolutely fine.
Thank you. Our society has no view
right
on that.
Okay.
Perhaps I could just add my own personal point of view on this. I would be concerned about allowing someone to apply for
minimal asset, if
it's reduced to 5 years. Now, I don't mean to say this in a condescending way, but we all know there are people in the world who have never really learned how to deal with their financial affairs. It might be an educational thing, it might just be their upbringing, whatever. There are certain people who will apply for one of these minimal asset bankruptcies and then just run up new debt. And they can run up new debt very quickly to quite a high level within 5 years. And then they just apply again. And now how many times would they be allowed to do this? Because for every application that is made, that is debt that's written off. And for a local authority, for example, who is very reliant on trying to recover debt income as much as possible, that's a huge loss to us when there are other measures that might help encourage that person to make a payment arrangement, for example. I think every 5 years is a bit too...
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. Are there any other areas of bankruptcy reform, either covered in the bill or which are not in the bill, that you think should be highlighted? Sorry, it's a very open question, I know, but... Mr. McPherson.
Thank you. Our society has given in its evidence a very narrow aspect, but it's a very practical point, and that is that because it is necessary with a bankruptcy action to serve the document on the person personally, at least under the first deliverance of the court, only personal service is acceptable. There is a very narrow window provided by the law at present for the service of a bankruptcy petition, no more than 14 days before the hearing and no fewer than 6 days before the hearing. And I think most sheriff officers find this really quite an extraordinary position to be in. We can understand that it's important for such an important appointment as a bankruptcy hearing at the court that person receiving the document should have plenty of time and therefore a minimum of 6 days, we can understand. But why should there be a requirement that the person is not given too much time? In no other circumstance, I think, are we in a position that we are unable to serve a document until a certain date has arrived. And our submissions mention the difficulties of us covering rural areas and the islands of Scotland and being able to arrange a visit which fits within eight days and can often be followed by the journey and the news that the person is on holiday and won't be back for another week makes us suggest, please, to the committee that you might look to widen the period in which it is competent for the service of a bankruptcy petition.
Mm. Yes, thank you. That's a very practical point. Thank you. Thank you for raising that. I don't know if Edinburgh Council have anything to add.
No.
Thank you. Okay, all right. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Colin Smith, be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Can I raise a number of questions about the Mental Health Moratorium Working Group? That the working group has recommended that only those in compulsory treatment should be able to access a mental health moratorium, which is quite a narrow criteria, and it's narrower than the definition in England and Wales. Can I ask if any of the panel have a view on this approach they would like to share with the committee?
If you maybe come to Edinburgh Council, first of all, and maybe in replying to Mr. Smith's question, could you maybe address how you would deal with a creditor who had mental health problems at the moment, if you were a debtor, sorry?
Obviously, there is a moratorium in place at the moment that people, regardless of whether or not it's mental health, that they... can access, so it covers everybody. I'm aware that obviously it's a narrower view for the mental health moratorium for a particular group of people. I'm not in a position to comment on the criteria because I'm not a mental health professional, but for us it's about once a decision has been made, the support that's in place for these citizens and our other citizens to be able to support them in taking forward access to information and support to allow them to make choices. Sorry, I've lost the thread of what you asked there, Colin.
Just following up on that point, you talk about the current standard moratorium in place at the moment. Now, that provides, at the moment, a six-month window. Obviously, that's increased from 6 weeks previously. There's a big debate, in fact, less than that, the big debate as to what that timeline should be. Now, is that six-month period, do you think, an appropriate period for the second phase of the mental health moratorium, which last week our witnesses said should be the case? In the work that you do, do you detect that that period of time is sufficient?
Because I was coming here today, I had a meeting with colleagues from our advice shop just to see how often they have put in place or recommended a moratorium for our citizens over the last year. And for them, the time that they actually recommend someone to go for that is if there is diligence action on the horizon. So rather than at the beginning, automatic, I know that some agencies automatically apply for the moratorium for a citizen. And it's not necessarily the case that they need it at the beginning, so that probably would eat into some of their time to allow them to make appropriate decisions on the direction of travel for them. So is it a long enough period of time? I guess, having listened to the evidence at some of the previous committees, if someone is in a mental health crisis at that time, are they in a position to even listen to some of the information that's given to them to then start the timeline effectively? I guess without statistics to be able to back that up, I'm a bit loath to anecdotally provide that. I think there needs to be evidence to say this is why and here's the access, and lots of other channels being looked at as to whether or not there's a blocker in a particular advice sector, or is it because they're not able to access appropriate NHS services to get them into a place to be able to speak about things. So that's a bit of a non-answer for me, because I think it needs to have facts around it to allow us to make effective choices for people or suggestions.
May I add something here? I realise the moratorium that is currently available is designed to serve a particular group of people, mostly people who perhaps are not in any kind of mental health crisis. They're just unable to deal with their debt. So that six-month moratorium gives them a period of time to consider what statutory-based debt solutions they might choose to follow, such as entering a DAS, for example, or perhaps assigning a trust deed. That six-month period is to give them time to consider all of those options. But this new moratorium is based on a completely different premise. This is for people who are unable mentally to deal with their debt. And as we all know, there's a huge range of conditions that could be considered mental illness, just from basic anxiety to depression to all-out psychosis. And a period of 6 months to help somebody deal with those issues may actually seem rather short, because in my own experience of dealing with mentally ill patients, it can take an awful lot longer than 6 months to resolve some of these anxiety issues. Some of them may even last a lifetime. And so I know that in England they have this extra provision of a 30-day breathing space, for example, at the end of the moratorium period. To my mind, that wouldn't work, because the initial phase of the moratorium, 6 months, is to help somebody seek medical assistance to get over their mental health issues, if they ever do. Adding on 30 days, I think in England the idea was just to allow, once they've been removed from the moratorium, to allow them time to get their financial affairs in order. If you have built up debt over 10 years, for example, you're not going to be able to get your financial affairs in order in 30 days. So I don't think that particular extension is very useful. Much better, in my view, is during the moratorium period that there are people in the background who can assist with the financial aspects of that person's difficulties whilst they are receiving treatment. It could be as simple as perhaps increasing powers of attorney. It would be great if somebody could have power of attorney to handle that person's financial affairs. I realise that a person has to have mental capacity to grant a power of attorney in the first place, but many people will have that capacity if they've not quite reached that severe level of mental distress. And then the two aspects can be dealt with at the same time during that moratorium. I also have a bit of an issue with the compulsory treatment order being a requirement to access this moratorium. Just looking at this from the point, I try to put myself in the shoes of a person in this situation. I would consider it perhaps humiliating, insulting, I don't know. It smacks a little bit of the sort of sentences that are handed out in some criminal cases where people are subjected to drug rehabilitation orders, for example. It smacks of a kind of a coercive system that may not always be appropriate for most of our debtors, I would say, are very decent people who are very keen to pay all their bills and pay their council tax. They might just have come across a brief period of instability. Perhaps they've got a bereavement in the family or there's illness or whatever. The last thing that person would be inclined to want to do is to be subjected to a compulsory treatment order. It smacks of somebody being sectioned, perhaps detained in a mental institution for a period. I just have a bit of a problem with that whole concept.
Okay. Mr. Smith?
So obviously somebody in that circumstance would be in phase one, which would last as long as the compulsory treatment, but somebody who's not had compulsory treatment order would only have that 6 month period. So is your concern that 6 month period may not be long enough for somebody to deal with their debt with a mental health problem?
That's true. And I feel when people are receiving treatment for mental health issues, I believe it can take an awful lot longer than 6 months to resolve those issues. In fact, it might even take a lifetime. So perhaps there is an option to extend the moratorium period to allow them to continue with their treatment, but only whilst there is provision in the background, say, with somebody with power of attorney, or to perhaps keep their financial affairs running whilst they're receiving the treatment. At least it comes down to a dignity thing. If I were that person, I would feel ashamed, humiliated, if I thought that my debt was left sitting untouched for 6 months. And then perhaps if the moratorium period was extended, that debt is still sitting there. It's not going anywhere. But if there's somebody else in the background through the money advisor system, perhaps, who can take over the role of making a payment arrangement, for example, or applying for direct deductions from benefit if the person's entitled to benefit, that sort of thing. At least the debt is being addressed, and that is all to the benefit of the debtor who's going through this crisis and who needs somebody to be taking care of their financial affairs on their behalf.
Can make some progress, Mr. Smith. I'll move over to Maggie Chapman before by Brian Wood.
Thanks very much, Claire, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. I'm wanting to continue Colin Smith's line of questioning around the mental health moratorium. Cheryl, earlier you highlighted the importance of early engagement and early engagement with the debtor, of the ability of the people that they're speaking to signpost to appropriate information. And I'm wondering, given what we've heard and Elizabeth, your comments just now are helpful, how do we make sure that people who are, or how do we make sure that you have the tools you need to support the people who are in that crisis point, whether it's the pre-moratorium phase or the moratorium phase itself? What is it that you would be looking for in this legislation to enable you, either in terms of information, in terms of powers, or in terms of that sort of capacity for direct engagement with debtors and you know, creditors? It might be the council, it might be someone else.
I think for me, it's about education, and that's not something that you can put into a bill, and making sure that people have the information, and that it might seem small, but that you've got the appropriate processes that are efficient to be able to use the resources that you've got to support these citizens, and everybody's doing it in a collaborative, joined up way. I know I've said early engagement, so for us as a council, we've got lots of touch points that we are having with our citizens on a daily basis. So we work very closely with our advice shop, and we will put a referral through if we need for one of our citizens, and they will then take them through the appropriate support that's there for them. That's our advice shop. But we also have a collaborative group with our citizens' advice colleagues, and making sure that we're doing things in a joined-up way. Also, the institute that we are part of, Revenue and Rateable Valuations, it's a subject that they talk about, and the Improvements Service are there as well, and making sure that councils, all 32 of them, talk about and support and do it in a joined up way. So as many people as possible having conversations. It's not necessarily the case that you need to put something in legislation. It's about education and making sure that the information is clear and concise, back to Andrew's point about the debt pack, and also different medias. I know that certainly for us, when we're doing training, it could be a video, because a lot of folks access a video in a certain way rather than having to read. And it's making sure that folk have got access to be able to use the information in a way that they understand. If they're not able to, that the support is there for them.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful. One of the things that the working group, the Mental Health Moratorium Working Group, has recommended is that obviously the moratorium, which that 6 month period could kick in after some of the medical treatment for that crisis care, but that would involve debt stopping of debt enforcement, freezing of interest, and stopping creditor contact. How would this affect your current engagement with debtors? How would it affect what would change in the way you were able to interact with them?
So it's about having the appropriate systems to record that information. We're not in a place to be able to decide whether or not that someone fits into that criteria. So we would be part of the process. If we are, I'm assuming we've been received some form of notification to say that a citizen is experiencing this and that they are in this mental health period, we would then have systems in place that would hold any contact with that citizen for the set period of time.
Okay, thanks. Roderick, can I come to you and ask how that moratorium and the timing of it would affect the people you interact with, whether they are in arrears or creditors themselves?
Well, thank you for your question. And our profession is very sensitive to and supportive of the work of the Parliament in looking to create a mental health moratorium. And in our evidence, we've just briefly said that you need to create a system which works in practice, to be practical. So it needs to be clear for those of us as the officers of court, so that we understand exactly the situations in which we will find ourselves. And it also needs to be equitable amongst the different stakeholders. So just a little point. If a person, in terms of mental health diagnosis, would seem by a certain way of looking at what the mental health moratorium should involve, would certainly qualify. But this person may have granted a power of attorney. This person might have a guardian. This person might have business advisors who are able to assist. This person might be possessed of great wealth. And in terms of being fair to all the stakeholders, we present this point. If there is a party that has the power of attorney, the attorney's job is to make sure that the assets of the person are dealt with as that person would have wished to have dealt with, and that person would have wished debts to be paid. And therefore, if a system were to miscarry to such an extent that it could be said that the debtor has the £1 million on deposit at the bank, and the creditor happens to be a small tradesman who has been through court and has a decree for £500, and that creditor is prevented because of the moratorium from ever being paid, that would be so far from being equitable. So there are, I think, some grey issues to be considered about what is fair between the different stakeholders. But from the point of view of appreciating the stress that a person may end up feeling under in a debt situation, we're very mindful of that. And we'd also like to call to your attention the fact that there are different stress levels involved in the different diligences that the law has provided. And I think the most stressful of all would be the execution of an exceptional attachment order, which made the law in 2002 and would involve the, if necessary, the forcing open of a dwelling house, the officer of court going in and valuing and removing assets from the house. These procedures are so very rare. I can say, well, that was in 2002. I've never carried through an exceptional attachment order. They really are exceptional. But the fact is, if someone is anxious about what might happen if sheriff officers come to call, and this is all part of the reason why they want the mental health moratorium, the exceptional attachment order is definitely at one extreme of the spectrum of how intrusive it is. But I just ask you to consider the effect of the bank arrestment. The bank arrestment involves no visit to the person's house. It involves the visit by the sheriff officer to the bank, a letter from the bank to the person reporting on whether that an arrestment has been carried out and that a certain sum of money has been attached. You know that, of course, the Parliament's work has been to set a minimum level of deductions that can be taken. There needs to be a minimum protected minimum balance of £1,000 in a bank account, which isn't being operated for business purposes. So my extreme scenario of the debtor with mental health issues who has £1 million in the bank, the act of an arrestment to allow the tradesman to be paid the £500 out of that sum on deposit I would suggest is on a completely different level of stress from the prospect of a sheriff officer coming with a power of entry to go into a house in the exceptional circumstances provided by the law since 2002 for exceptional attachment orders. And to be fair to all the stakeholders, I'm sure the committee will bear this in mind.
Thank you. That's useful, but I mean, you started your comments by saying, you know, it has to work in practice, and I think if we were to have gradations of levels of fairness within the mental health moratorium, that might become unwieldy. And I'm also mindful of that those extreme hard cases not necessarily being how our laws, or, you know, that they shouldn't necessarily be the baseline for where we make our laws. So there's one final question just around this, and maybe Cheryl or Elizabeth, coming back to you, just a question around that process of interaction between money advisors and debtors and creditors, I suppose. Do you see the sort of level of debt repayment necessarily changing as a consequence of the mental health moratorium merely just being delayed? Do you see that as being the consequence of this?
I don't think the level of engagement will be delayed, because at the moment we work really effectively with our citizens, in my opinion, and also our advice shop's opinion. And the joined up approach, you know, for us, that's the key. And making sure that people, regardless of what stage they're at, have the access to information. So it wouldn't delay anything, because people would be supported effectively at the moment. And the early warning signs before someone comes to, you know, the point where their debt has reached a certain point, there'll have been lots of interactions with us and support from possibly key workers.
Okay. Thanks. I'll leave it there, Claire.
Thank you, Brian Muttle.
Thank you, Gavina. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for being here. I've been listening really intently to the answers you've been giving to some of my colleagues, and I was really going to ask around the Mental Health Moratorium Working Group's recommendation that a mental health moratorium would be applied for via a money advisor. And it strikes me, Mr. McPherson, because one of the things I was considering here is what we don't talk about is the creditor. And there are certain circumstances where the creditor is the one that maybe is being done here. But in your particular scenario you set there, of somebody sitting with £1 million in the bank, you know, with a tradesman, we look at £500, which happens often, it strikes me that it's hugely unlikely that person would be seeking a money advisor. So I'm not quite sure that scenario would arise. I think the what I was going to say around the fact that it has to be applied for through a money advisor. My concern here is that does that money advisor sector have the capacity to deal with that? Do they have the skill set? Are they trained to deal with the ability to recognise, you know, people in a mental health situation, and then they have to then be able to access mental health services? So I suppose, you know, I'll come to you, Cheryl, if I could, in the first instance. Does the sector have the capacity? Because we're making laws and regulations based on ideal situation, and we're not in, this is by far from an ideal situation. So back to the practicality, does the sector have the capability?
Having spoken to my colleague yesterday, it's whether or not they would have the experience from a professional point of view to identify, you know, a set criteria for the moratorium. So they would need to be comfortable with the skill set and the training, if it was that group of staff, to be able to decide, to be able to assist these citizens effectively. So it would be a mental health professional, and this is my personal opinion, that would decide that this person meets this criteria, and then where do you go from there? Because not every single person that is in a mental health crisis has debt. So it's on a case-by-case basis, I would suggest. I did ask my colleague yesterday how many referrals she had made through in the last year for the normal moratorium, and that would be at present folks who are potentially suffering a mental health crisis, and it was less than 10 that they had made through in the last year. And no, certainly from evidence on the committee on the 13th, colleague had mentioned in England it was 2% of the moratorium caseload. It depends on the size of the caseload in the first place, so I couldn't really comment on whether or not folks would have the capacity to be able to deal with a mental health moratorium. It's mainly around the training on whether or not they would be in a position to identify these citizens as fitting into that criteria. But at the moment, everyone receives assistance, regardless of mental health.
Thank you. I mean that's very helpful. I think my concern here is that, you know, mental health is such a sliding scale, and you know, we have a significant rise in poor mental health, and it's not, and it, from my experience, people with poor mental health can be very good at hiding it, and we don't, and so people go to college or and to university for 3-4 years to be able to recognise this. My concern is in what's being asked here is that it's money advisors who are being charged with recognising that, and that's the point I'm really trying to push here, is that recognition, and then the ability to call in. You know, we should have the ability to call in mental health experts. You know, where do we sit with that? I don't know if anybody will be able to come in with that one, but where do we sit with comfort with that particular issue?
I'm going to bring Kevin Stewart in a sec. I think the proposal is that someone would have to be in receipt of treatment. It would have to be, and that's the reason why the choice is maybe to restrict, because of the difficulty of defining. But do you want to, is anything additional to Brian Whittle before I bring in Kevin Stewart? Something?
May I just briefly say, you're right, of course, my example with £1 million in the bank is an extravagant figure to mention. But I would have thought people perhaps with substantial amounts on deposit would still be looking for a money advisor, particularly where the money is, as it were, spoken for dealing with funding for perhaps for a care package, for a care home. There may be all sorts of situations in which people with a largish amount on deposit are still very mindful of the money running out, and that there may be the situation where, again, getting back to the example, the decree's been granted for payment of £500. What is equitable if it proves impossible to be able to proceed with actually asking to be paid that £500 because of consequences of a mental health moratorium?
Okay, I'll bring in.
And I'll be very brief, convener. First of all, to Ms Hind and Ms McCrossan, I'm very pleased to hear you use the term citizens rather than customers, because it annoys me when councils refer to citizens as customers. But my very brief question is around about those frontline staff who are immensely important to you in terms of picking up difficulties. Are your frontline staff in Edinburgh trauma-informed? Have they had trauma-informed practice training, which can often be immensely useful in terms of picking up some of the points around about mental health difficulties that folk may have?
It's certainly one of the tools within the box that we have. We've got an extensive training programme for our staff to be able to recognise, regardless of the point of contact, whether it be face-to-face or on the phone. I guess an example would be Alzheimer's as well. That's some of the training that our staff undergo. So annually, what we have is a training programme and it gets added to, dependent on the feedback that's coming through to say whether or not there's a particular aspect that we feel that we're just not getting there on, or there's something new come through to allow us to support our citizens more effectively. So it's not one size fits all, depending on the front facing or if it's over the phone. So it's different skill sets that you have to be able to use. But yes, that is something that we take forward as part of our training.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Brian Whittle, did you wish another question briefly?
Just very, very quickly, if I could. The financial moratorium to the bill argues there will be no significant costs to the local authorities as a result of a mental health moratorium. I can see hidden costs there. I wonder if we know what your your consideration is around potential costs of the bill to councils.
Obviously, from a council point of view, being able to effectively collect and spend funds for us as a council is key, and there needs to be the balance between collection, as I said previously, and taking into account individuals' circumstances for ability to pay. The hidden costs, I guess, it is unknown at this time for me. I having read through, I couldn't, and maybe this is perhaps my lack of knowledge with the state on the maturity of this at the moment, on what those, you know, costs could start to unravel. Budget-wise, for us as a council, we need to be mindful it's public funds, so you have to consider what the impact of that would be to be able to support citizens effectively in delivering this for them. So I guess for me, I'm saying I can't really comment on what those potential hidden costs could be. Sorry, I can't really answer that.
Okay. Can I just ask a final question? Myrtle Fraser raised minimum asset process as the reduction in years is another policy area we maybe want to explore. The other area that's been raised with the committee is bank arrestments. The allowance for bank arrestments went up to £1,000. There's a proposal that wage arrestments should also go up to £1,000. Of Edinburgh want to comment on what impact the changes to the bank arrestment made and if you would be supportive or if you think it's a case that wage arrestments should be increased to £1,000.
I don't personally have an opinion on that one.
There is a schedule that the sheriff officers use to determine how much can be taken from someone's earnings based on what their earning level is. Now, I don't know the figures to hand, but I'm sure consideration is or could be taken as to what does that person's income support? Does it just support them? Does it support their household, their family? Do they have young children? I don't know if there's a room there for flexibility in terms of how much is arrested or if they have to stick to the strict figures that are on this schedule. I'm not quite sure who produces that schedule, actually, but it's a certain percentage of earnings.
Yeah, I don't know if the sheriff officer has any view on that. I'm understanding it's around £550 is protected for wages arrestment, while banks, it's £1,000.
It's certainly £1,000 for banks. Now, whether that, to me, that was just put forward and that's a nice round figure. I certainly haven't seen any statistical evidence to say that's the correct figure. It may well be the correct figure, but there's been, to our knowledge, there's no statistical evidence to support that £1,000 and therefore the same for earnings arrestment. Is it the right figure? Who knows? Certainly, it seemed to just run through that £1,000 was accepted. In terms of the point about whether earnings arrestments can be varied, that is talking about complicating matters. You can say, yes, I'm a married man with children and I'm supporting 2-3 children and a wife and a house, and therefore I should have X amount allowed to be take home in my pay and only a smaller amount. What happens if you're not married, if you're supporting kids out with your family home? What happens if both of you are working? If you're working, your partner, wife, husband has a larger income. To start dictating, trying to work out how you vary an earnings estimate, there certainly has to be one figure we would think is the only workable answer in that respect. But whether that's £1,000, I think, is an enormous debate, and I don't think that that debate was properly made at the time of the change for the bank arrestment.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you to the witnesses this morning. I'll now briefly suspend the meeting while we change over our panel. Our next item of business this morning is an evidence session on the independent review of the skill delivery landscape report by James Withers, and I welcome James Withers to the committee. I'd be grateful if members and the witness could be as concise as possible with questions and answers. And first of all, if you want to just give us an update on, since the report was published in June, how you feel about the government's response to it and if there's been any discussions with government over the summer around implementation.
Sure, okay. Morning, everyone. Thanks, Kavina, for the invite this morning. So back in May, the report was published. I had a meeting with the Skills Minister last week to kind of update as to where things were. I think I'd probably characterise my view of where things are as I've been pretty heartened by the response. There were certainly some initial moves around commitments to single funding body, around the future of skills planning. And I think that, from my perspective, was quite good to hear before recess, so there wasn't a sort of vacuum over the summer. But I think my sense is Scottish Government ministers are taking their time to consider all the implications of I suppose, what I've set out in the report. And I'm very conscious I've, I suppose, landed them with a significant reform job. You know, I had some critiques of the skill system as it stands just now. And I think that the complexity of the system means that the reform itself will be complex. I suppose, I mean, just to keep my answer concise, you know, there were reforms in delivery elements that I felt were needed, big structural reforms in how the whole system is set up. But probably more than that, cultural reforms in how we think about a learning system as a whole, and to try and move beyond what I concluded was a real chasm and divide, a false divide that exists between education on the one hand and vocation on the other. So it's a significant reform job. I think it'll take a few years, but my gut feeling is that the response has been heartening in terms of support for the direction of travel, but it will take some time to work through the detail.
Okay, thank you. I do recognise that the report, you know, made a point of saying it's not a real review mirror, it's not an appraisal of past performance. But, you know, what you said this morning is significant critiques of the system, real need for cultural reform, for big structural reform. Do you think these reforms are overdue? Has there been a lack of direction, leadership from government or from other agencies? Because you've painted a fairly... I suppose you do make... it's a critical report, and it's fairly significant, the structural reforms that are outlined. Do you feel there has been that these are overdue and that there's been a lack of attention from government in these areas?
So the review was evidence-led. I've had experience of the skills system for 15, 20 years, but through a fairly narrow lane of business view and an employer's view. And it became, you know, very clear to me starting the work how complex and how broad the system was and how complex the customer base was. What I would say is in the hundreds of people I interacted with within the review, I didn't meet a single person either within the system in terms of delivery responsibilities or as a customer of it who felt the system was working optimally. Mm-hmm. I think in terms of the direction it's going, because of the scale of economic transformation, I think, that's coming to Scotland and, I suppose, the world in terms of race to net zero, digitalisation, automation, AI and all the impact of that, that even if the system was working optimally, I don't believe it would be fit for the future that's coming. So I think there is has been a lack of leadership from government. The system has been allowed to evolve. I think systems evolve naturally themselves, but they don't reform themselves. I think there is no clear description of what good looks like from the system. When I started the review, my first question was, if we're going to build a system for 10 years' time, have we agreed what good looks like? And in reality, there were many different definitions of that, depending on what part of the skill system you were in. So I think that there's been too passive an approach by government over years to allow the system to evolve, and it needs much clearer leadership and a much clearer vision if all parts of the system are going to work collectively. And they're not doing that, in my view. They're all working within their own individual area, and they don't view themselves collaboratively as working as a single system. And just a final point on that I would say is there's a terrific amount of good in the system. I met nothing but passionate individuals who were keen to make a difference in terms of skills delivery. However, the way the system is structured and set up has embedded a fragmentation.
Okay, thank you. Colin Beattie to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Mira. I know that in your review you note that setting out how to implement your recommendations was really beyond the scope of the review. Nonetheless, obviously you've been immersed in this and you have a very good in-depth knowledge of the whole system. What do you see as the biggest single barrier to successfully realising the vision for Scotland's skills system that you've outlined?
I don't think there's a single agreed vision or definition of success for the system. So I think there's no North Star that everyone is pointed towards. And whether you speak to those that are involved in colleges or universities or those involved in delivery of apprenticeships and training, they'll have their own different view of what success looks like. And even I think strategic guidance letters that go to government are focused on individual agencies and what they're expected to deliver. And that makes sense, but it doesn't treat them as though they're part of this coherent system. So saying implementation was beyond my remit sounds a little bit of a cop-out. And in a sense, what I did was take a whole system review. So my concern was in previous attempts to reform, I suppose, other parts of the public sector, it's very easy to go down rabbit holes of short-term efficiencies, of headcounts. My view is the need to step back and look at the system as a whole and think about what it should be trying to deliver for the customer base. The downside of that approach is it doesn't get into the nitty-gritties of the practicalities of how you move functions between one part of the public sector to another. But to your question, a very clear definition of what success looks like is critical. And for me, the system has to consider itself as a single learning system, not a system that is built around, you know, a huge fork in the road, whether you either go down, you know, education and learning route or you go down a vocation and skills route, because I think that is leaving people behind.
But I think what you're saying is there is no one single barrier to the implementation of realising the vision. But it might be different for different component parts. If that's so, and if the vision is different for the component parts, won't that still lead to fragmentation? There should be one vision. The barriers should be fairly self-evident within that. How do you avoid the fragmentation that comes from you've got your universities here, you've got your Skills Development Scotland here, and so on? How do you see that coming together?
So I suppose this is really where the structural reform comes in, and I saw five very clear moving parts to that. So as things stand at the moment, you've got funding split across two different agencies. You've got qualifications split across at least two different agencies with others feeding into that. We've got university and college qualification development set up entirely separately to our apprenticeship framework. So to me, it's not a surprise that apprenticeships remain, you know, distinct from the core learning system. They're over here, shoved into a separate agency with separate annualised uncertain budgets, capped numbers. They're not embedded into the heart of the system. So that was my view around there should be a single funding agency covering all post-16 learning. There should be a single qualifications body. So there's going to be a new qualifications body that should take a view beyond just what happens at schools, but into apprenticeship development, other vocational training as well. Then enterprise agencies need to take the crystal clear lead in terms of business support. At the moment, if you're a business, you might go, if you're looking at workforce development, you might go to your local enterprise agency, the job centre, you might go to a local authority, you might go to SDS. So having clarity on what different agencies had responsibility for across the entire system for their particular element to me was critical. The system was incredibly complex, and I heard a lot of evidence, people bewildered by the complexity. I was not inherently concerned about complexity, because I think the system needs to be complex because the customer base is incredibly complex. People of different ages, aspirations, backgrounds, barriers, different parts of the country. The issue was not complexity, it was a lack of clarity and confusion as to who was doing what, even within the system itself. I don't think I met anyone within the skills system that had an overview of every moving part of it.
Just to bring you back to the original question, it was about barriers and what barriers there are to realising these changes.
I think the barriers for realising these changes, aside from being clear on what the vision is you're trying to achieve, are probably similar to other elements of public sector reform. I think it needs time and tolerance. I'm not entirely entirely sure those are two things that are offered very often in terms of public sector reform, because the desire to see benefits quickly. I don't think the benefits of this will be seen particularly quickly. They'll be longer term. I think the lack of short-term wins and benefits will be seized upon by those in the system who are opposed to change. So I think that's actually part of the critical barrier, and it will require a strong ministerial and political stomach and hopefully cross-party support in order to drive it through. So I see the barriers actually as political more than an ability to actually build a system that can be done, because other countries have systems that work in different ways. I didn't see any lift in place elsewhere for Scotland, but I have no doubt we have the building blocks to build the skills system, which would be actually a competitive advantage for Scotland. I think the barriers are most likely to be barriers in similar to other areas of public sector reform.
Thank you, Maggie Charlton, followed by Brian Buttle.
Thanks very much, Claire, and good morning, James. Thanks very much for being here this morning, but also for all of the work that's gone into this report. I want to pick up on points that you've mentioned around the possible complexities of our future economy. You mentioned net zero, you mentioned AI, digitisation, all of that. And I think one of the challenges, as you've just outlined, nobody has an overview of all of the moving parts. And if we take something like net zero, we have so many different streams coming into the net zero skills and training space, so many different possibilities as well. And how I hear what you said to Colin about, you know, implementation wasn't your game, but how do you think we can actually ensure that we get an implementation that it aligns in some ways? I'm minded, as you were speaking, of the work of Mariana Mazzucato, and that the sort of challenge-based and mission-based approach rather than government department-based. How is it that we can actually move into that overall systems-based approach that does take account of the different ages, the different demographics, different geographies in the net zero space at the moment? What are the things we need to be looking at?
So I think there are some real challenges around the net zero space, because I heard reference multiple times, almost every day I was involved in this, to green skills. You then ask, what are these green skills? And there's a gap there. So there's a real need to understand what we're talking about in that sense. I think the other thing is, because I don't think anyone can predict, we can have a good go at it, but anyone can predict with real accuracy what our economy and society is going to look like in 10 years' time because of the scale of change that's coming. Therefore, I think we need to focus on a workforce that is going to be agile. I think there are building block skills, whether they're called micro-credentials, meta-skills, whatever the jargon might be, but the ability to build problem-solving, communication, innovation, those kind of core skills I think will be critical. To me, the one thing I would predict is we're going to have multiple different types of jobs that require to be filled by multiple different types of people. And my concern about the skills system at the moment is there's something of a war between those who advocate for full-time education, the so-called golden pathway to university, and those that argue, why are we warehousing people in years of endless university education when we need to knock them into the workplace as soon as possible? Whereas in reality, we're going to need both of those things. But the way the skills system is set up, you have agencies that advocate for those different parts. I met all of them, and they would make a compelling case of why we should be taking funding from one part to another. And I could have taken a very easy step and just said we need more money for apprenticeships. But it would have, you know, if you move money from one part of a fragmented system to another, you're still left with a fragmented system. I think the other thing, and this is a really difficult onus I've put on government, is the need for better prioritisation. I think there are probably 2, 3, 4 national priorities in terms of skills development that Scotland needs to prioritise. From that, I think we should be asking all regions to respond to that. But beyond those top 2 or 3, and I've copped out by not naming them, but I think that's where ministerial leadership, political leadership and parliamentary leadership comes in to identify what those priorities are, and there'll be judgment calls on that. But beyond that, release the regions and local areas to crack on and give them greater autonomy and control over funding to determine what particular priorities might be in their areas beyond these bigger national priorities.
Can I just unpick that a little bit and I might ask you to name what might be okay. A priority area, because I think one of the challenges is is there a danger that we replicate the same kind of compartmentalisation and silo effect that currently exists by doing exactly that. You over there can do this, you over there can do this. And yet actually we need them to be talking to each other. We need to break down all of those silos. And, you know, we see it in macroeconomic structures like the European Union, where there was specializations of economic activity that has led to weaknesses now. And I'm wondering how we ensure that we don't reproduce that in the skills space, you know, whether it's net zero, whether it's AI, whatever it is. In Scotland more generally?
Yeah, so it's absolutely a risk. You know, most people support prioritisation until you realise you're not a priority or you pick the wrong priority. So there is absolute risks in that. I think what I see, you know, one of the tensions within the system was this tension about what should be done nationally and what should be done regionally. And I'm sure it's true across a whole number of areas of public sector delivery. But my view is that Scotland will have some competitive advantages or opportunities or distinct workforce challenges that require a national approach. And from that, the execution of that national approach may tweak slightly different in regional areas. But for me, what I saw, I'll take the college sector as an example, and I was blown away by that sector. I have to say, I had an outdated view of the college sector. I hadn't spent, until I did this, much time inside our colleges. I thought they were a phenomenal asset. And yet they're so often constrained. A national agency will, you know, they'll need permission to determine whether they can shift some apprenticeship places from one framework to another. They're often rooted in communities, connected to businesses, connected to the schools. It strikes me that if these institutions are there receiving not far short of £1 billion a year, we can trust them to determine some of those priorities beneath the big national, big ticket items.
Okay. Just a very, very quick final point on your point. I think that's been a frustration for many of us around the definition of green skills and the definition of actually what low carbon or net zero jobs actually are. And then, you know, it's not necessarily in construction, in energy, in those kind of industries. We can be talking about care. We can be talking about the more vocational elements that you were highlighting. And is that really an opportunity for us to try and bring the vocation versus sort of the sort of golden pathway that you described together in a way?
Yeah, I think so. For me, there's a real need for more work-based learning opportunities from as early an age as possible. So my remit wasn't really to look into schools, but I felt I couldn't do this review without doing it. So I had to look at career service in schools, look at how foundation apprenticeship works, and actually work fairly closely at times with Louise Hayward, who's doing the review into qualifications as well. And it strikes me that I just don't see this distinct divide between vocation and education. So if I took a graduate apprenticeship, I think it's a poor name for what it is, because it doesn't describe what it is, but degree apprenticeships, as they call them, south of the border, which I think is a better name for it. That's a classic example where you're bringing the world of work and the world of tertiary education together in one through a single vehicle, which I think is a fantastic vehicle. And the fact that there are, you know, universities down south who will do more in a single year than all of Scotland combined suggests that we've got greater potential in that area. And that brings those two, you know, that would be an example of how you can bring those two worlds together and not see them as somehow separate.
Okay. Thanks, Claire.
Thank you very much. Brian Whittle to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you. Good morning, James. Good to see you. Really interested in this area, I have to say. And just to follow on from Maggie Chapman talking about the green economy, I would throw in the blue economy as well, if you don't mind. I think we all recognise there's a massive opportunity for Scotland here in terms of the skills development. My concern is we're not weaving those potential skills and that potential for our pupils into our schools. For example, construction industry, we're saying they need an extra 22,500 tradespeople and engineers by 2028 to hit government 2030 targets. And the reality is that's not going to happen. And the reason it's not going to happen, I believe, is when we talk about green skills, you know, if you speak to a lot of people, they think that's planting trees rather than software engineers and whatnot. And we also have really pleased to hear you talk about the FE sector in the way that you do, but we also have an FE sector where they have unfilled apprenticeship places, and then we have engineering companies screaming for engineers. So we're not bringing the two together. That's basically where I'm going. So where did you have a look at how we are weaving the future, what the future needs are, into our education system at the earliest possible opportunity?
Yeah, so it's an absolutely critical area. And this is where I saw the potential to much better embed a truly national career service. So I think it's interesting, when I spoke to colleges, who would be, some would be overwhelmed with demand from people wanting to go into the beauty industry or hairdressing. And I met the Commission on Land-Based Learning, who didn't have that same demand for people to get into forestry. And there's a whole piece around that. You can't be what you can't see. Everyone goes to hairdresser. You know, you see that it's very real. Not everyone has experience of an engineering firm or jobs. And I think that the ability to build career service, which is not just about, and my recommendation was that SDS loses a significant number of its functions, but recasts itself as that careers agency, which is not the same as doing everything, but provides momentum to really embed it into communities and local areas. And that means providing greater opportunity to see what the career and economic opportunity will be for individuals. And I think there is a gap between what people certainly see at school in terms of career options and actually what the opportunities are in the workplace. And if they could see that, I think there's more likely that they will eventually be that. And I think that disconnect is really challenging. Now, just a final point would be, this whole area around skills has probably felt a little bit death by review, because there's been the Muir report, there has been, Graham Smith did brilliant work around careers, I've done my review. I think what Louise Hayward has looked at around the future of qualification curriculum is really interesting, where beyond having individual subject hires and qualifications, there would be potentially more general Scottish diploma, kind of baccalaureate in Scotland. But the third part, a work-based and community-based learning, I think would provide the opportunities to raise greater awareness of the future in engineering, green jobs, blue economy jobs as well. And that disconnect exists. And I spoke to school pupils who would still view the career service as the place you are sent if you're failing academically. And that is where our system, I think, is still failing. And with an agency with that as a narrow focus, I think there's more chance of getting that right, as challenging as it is.
Thank you. I'm also interested around this idea of where there's a national framework and how that devolves down into, you know, local economy. You know, the obvious one would be the transition from oil and gas into green economy. I mean, that's very much a northeast, you would imagine, is where the predominance of that's going to be, and how they make the decisions up there. And the other point I was going to ask you around was I was with a group on Monday who, working with disenfranchised children at school, who now go to school 2 days a week and go to them 3 days a week. So I suppose it's a really complex. Complex, you know, landscape out there. How do we create a national framework that allows all that really good work still to happen?
So I've talked about national prioritisation, so I won't mention that again. What I've suggested is the functions of skills planning sit within Scottish Government and come out of what is a mix of Scottish Funding Council and Skills Development Scotland. That requires a consistent regional template, I think, for skills planning. Not for regional skills plan to be done by government, but have a consistent approach to it, because I don't think Scotland is big enough to justify having lots of different frameworks for how we do skills planning. The question is, where do you do that skills planning? And that's not an easy one to answer. My instinct says that our city region areas, our eight kind of city region, city deal partnership areas, are potentially the vehicle to do that. They need to get a proper representation of people around the table. I heard from some colleges who weren't around the table, SME businesses as well, often feel they weren't around the table. But I think those kind of, if they're the right geographic areas, they're the best model I've seen yet for potentially doing that. And I think if we can trust these partnerships, who in many cases don't have a constitutional body as such, they are a collaboration of people. If we can trust them with steering billions of pounds of investment, capital investment things, I think we can trust them with the skills planning that sits alongside that as well.
Okay, thank you. Colin Smith, be followed by Myrtle Fraser.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, James. I'm interested in the boundaries of city region deals, given that in my area the borders is in two, including one in the north of England. But I won't go there at the moment. I want to highlight the issue you raise about the cluttered landscape, with obviously several organisations often having overlapping responsibilities and that lack of a one-stop shop for the customer base. But you don't suggest decluttering the number of players in the landscape. Instead, you recommend collaboration is built into the design of the bodies. So how do you do that, given the fact we've been here before with Enterprise and Skills Review in 2016, and that interagency competition is probably even worse now than it was before that review?
So you're right. I didn't. I suppose there was no bonfire of agencies within my review. It was about much greater clarity into what their roles were. So, in a sense, a much narrower, tighter, clearer focus for Skills Development Scotland in one area, which is careers, and they do brilliant work in delivering that at the moment. But that was an example where I felt there's an inherent conflict in Skills Development Scotland's ability to deliver impartial skills advice, whilst at the same time being the advocates and delivery agent for one part of the skills system, which was apprenticeships. And I think if you to provide proper impartial advice to people of all ages on skills, you need to have no skin in the game on any part of that particular system. So in a sense, there might be a great naive call that collaboration will just happen between bodies. But I come back probably to my point about that crystal clarity on what the whole system is trying to achieve, and then getting people in their lane in a way. So funding dealt with by one body, qualifications by one body, careers by one body, business support led by one body, skills planning led by one body. And then it requires an inherent amount of collaboration. I'm not sure amalgamating them all into a giant agency would necessarily deliver that collaboration. I think that's a cultural point more than it is about a structural point. And probably ministers being very robust in holding agencies to account in terms of how they are delivering that skill system. I would say I took it as read in my review that the sort of three institutions that the Muir report had recommended to establish in terms of education, that was set, ministers had announced that. So if I'd gone for that real amalgamation, I would have had to stretch well into areas probably that reviews had done before. So my view was that if we could achieve a prize of clarity, first of all, then that would address a huge amount of the issues that are there in the skill system at the moment. But that's not to say in 10 years' time someone's door's chapped and asked whether we should be amalgamating agencies, even if their roles are clearer.
So how do you, so there will still be agencies that will have effectively overlapping responsibilities, that's the nature of the enterprise network, for example, South of Scotland, Scottish Enterprise, that they'll still have, even local authorities will still have an element of overlapping responsibilities. So how far do we need to go? Do we need to change those responsibilities, or is there any other mechanism that we can put in place that ensures at the very least somebody takes a lead? Because often the experience in, for example, regional economic partnerships is that several organisations have similar responsibilities, but nobody actually leads on it. So how do we put in the mechanisms? What mechanisms do we need to put in to make sure we actually get somebody delivering and actually taking the lead on that when they do have that overlapping, I suppose, responsibility? Because some of these responsibilities are quite general, they're not often specific.
So in the context of skills planning, my view was that the responsibility to ensure skills planning happens sits with government. The population of a skills plan, a regional skills plan, is devolved down to, in my view, a city region. But the prize of having greater autonomy over funding, the prize over having greater autonomy over establishing educational provision in an area, is won by demonstrating you have a clear regional skills plan and, crucially, a clear delivery plan as well. So that plan would require to set who's going to do what, when, and having that clarity on who does what would, in effect, win you this prize of having greater autonomy over funding, which largely doesn't exist at the moment. So my hope would be that would act as a catalyst to provide greater clarity as to who does what. But I completely accept, there will be overlapping responsibilities, what an enterprise agency and a local authority does. I think in terms of the enterprise agencies, My point was that they should be the first port of call for workforce development and business, because at the moment what happens, you have SDS having that responsibility. Let's say Scottish Enterprise has a broader responsibility for business innovation, but where does the line stop between what is workforce innovation and or workforce development and business innovation? It was becoming too blurred, and even the enterprise agencies would say that there wasn't clarity or sufficient collaboration in terms of how they work with Skills Development Scotland to try and work through that, and in a sense, without that good collaboration, the overlaps are become barriers rather than good opportunities for strategic collaboration.
Thank you. Murdo Fraser, followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, James.
Morning,
can I just go back to some of the answers you gave to Maggie Chapman around the question of apprenticeships? And there's a lot in your report around apprenticeships and apprenticeship funding, and you've already expressed your view around graduate apprenticeships, which I think are really, really exciting development for people who want to experience work but also get a qualification. One of the frustrations I find when I speak to employers is that they're offering apprenticeships but feel they're not getting any sort of support from the public sector in terms of funding. When I speak to Skills Development Scotland around this, they recognise that. They say that there's a large oversubscription in terms of apprenticeship places. Now, I heard what you say about funding, but you think it's fair that apprenticeships have become the poor relation in terms of the skills landscape, and do we need to do more to try and level up the funding for apprenticeships?
So I think this is where the whole parity of STEAM question comes in. I think they have been the poor relationship. And I would say that not so much as a statement on funding, although I think there are real issues around funding levels and the ability to meet the demand that there are. I think in terms of how we view apprenticeships. So if a foundation apprenticeship, another vehicle, which I think is brilliant, but with a terrible name, but we'll put that to one side. If we consider that as an option, that a level 6 foundation apprenticeship has the same parity of esteem as a level 6 hire. We call them different things. They are treated differently by different people. And I think pupils and parents have a perception that it's what you do as one of the better, second best options if you're not going to be firing to university. So I think there's a real issue around culturally how we perceive apprenticeships. Where I think there's an ability to do more is to stop hiving off the whole apprenticeship system into a separate agency with separate funding. I think that cements the separation of that from the learning system. That should be absolutely, for me, embedded into the heart of qualification development in the same way that secondary school qualifications development, other forms of vocational training are developed. I think the funding should sit in that same agency. I would like to see universities having the freedom to utilise their core funding that they get from SFC to deliver degrees either through apprenticeships or through full-time study. Why we have that separated off, capped, uncertain, it seems to me that it's not surprising they are seen as there's a separate other thing you can do over here if you don't follow the mainstream. If we want to change that and make it the mainstream, I think we need to make it the mainstream, really, and put it into the heart of it would be my view. There's real challenges around funding. It wasn't for me to take a view on the future of tuition fee funding, but when you have £1 billion going into free tuition fee, it massively limits your ability to do other things with the 3.2 billion in total, which is spent in skills. But providing greater flexibility to use funding, and crucially in local areas, if there is demand for apprenticeships, giving freedom to institutions to build provision and use funding to try and tap into that, greater trust and autonomy for them to do that, I think would be a good thing and might start freeing up this. We need more apprenticeships. We need more work-based learning. But I didn't, for me, it was too simplistic to just say, put more money into apprenticeships, because the current system would deem that as taking money from university or college full-time education provision and putting it into apprenticeships. And to me, that would continue this sort of spirit of fragmentation, and that these two worlds are too divided.
Yeah, okay, thanks. That's really helpful. Just on that issue of funding, did you look at all at the apprenticeship levy and how that's allocated? Because one of the things I hear from employers who are UK-wide is that south of the border, there's much more transparency around the apprenticeship levy and how they can access that. In Scotland, that just seems to go into the block grant, and I've asked parliamentary questions to try and understand how much of that apprenticeship levy money comes down to actually funding apprenticeships. And, you know, it's like getting through treacle trying to understand that. So were you any more successful in trying to understand where that funding goes?
So in all honesty, I didn't spend much time on the apprenticeship levy. I viewed it as a kind of policy question. So I ducked it in a sense. What I would say is, you know, in my experience of it, so if I go back to my old job in businesses, it's certainly cloudy at best as to who's paying it and where it goes. I think my wider concern about the apprenticeship levy is it has probably dented some faith in the business community in the wider skills system. But I think if we can provide a clearer system, a stronger career system too, which truly emphasises the opportunities across a whole different set of industries and different type of roles, and we can build greater employer engagement in the system, because at the moment I think there's good employer engagement in apprenticeship development frameworks. I think SDS have done that well, and they've had the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board that have done that as well, but it's only one part of the system. Building a better business voice in shaping the entire learning system hopefully will help overcome some of the scars that certainly are from an apprenticeship levy system, of which there are certainly businesses in Scotland that don't have a huge amount of faith that they've paid into it and got their value back out of it.
Okay, thanks very much.
Kevin Stewart, would you wish to come in with a question just now?
I've just got a very brief question, and it's round about the green skills aspect of this. And we've kind of touched upon this already, that many of the jobs and many of the courses that we have fit in very well with the green skills agenda. Talking to an oil and gas company in the main last night at Scottish Renewables, there is a direct move that could be undertaken between the work that they're doing now in oil and gas into renewables. Is there a recognition amongst the skills sector, whether that be SDS, the colleges, the university, that is the case, and that some of the adaptation that needs to be undertaken is pretty small indeed?
So I think there is broad understanding from the delivery part of the skills system of how that adaptation and that economic evolution will manifest itself. I think there is still a too weak use of data and labour market intelligence and business intelligence to understand exactly what that will look like. I think there are really good models out there that could be expanded. I've identified that the Glasgow City Region Intelligence Hub, who are using really, really good data, not just churned out of a computer, but also informed by businesses on the ground as to what the skills requirements are versus the provision that needs to feed that. I think still a lot of labour market intelligence, which is done centrally, doesn't speak to particular sectors and doesn't seem necessarily that accurate, actually, in terms of, and I remember looking at that from my old job in food and drink. So that's where, again, I think a greater responsibility, power and autonomy for regions and places to be able to determine how to respond to that, I think that would be better. But broadly, I think there is an understanding that this evolution is there, that actually there are probably some quick wins and steps to tap into that. And I do think that while saying we need to, you know, I've taken a whole system review on this, I think there are pilots and things that could be done to trial different things in different areas to hopefully provide a model for to follow.
Thank you. And in terms of that data gathering, you mentioned the Glasgow aspect, and in my own patch in the northeast of Scotland, the likes of Opportunity Northeast are doing similar things. The intelligence is good, the data is good, but do you think that some of our institutions are actually talking enough and, probably more importantly, listening to business and their future needs?
So not sufficiently, or in a way that represents the full business base. So I think there are some really good big business employers who also have the resources to engage with the institutions. I think SDS has got some really good relationships with some of the bigger employers in Scotland. I think the smaller businesses, medium-sized businesses even, I think their voice is lost in the system. And that's part of the reason I think the DYW network has real potential to be accelerated and become that employer voice. I have other views within this about how the DYW network could potentially evolve, but I think that putting that employer voice into the heart of the whole system would be an inherently good thing. Now, that's different from the system being set up to serve employers. And one of my concerns is I saw parts of the system looking as though it existed to serve the needs of business more than the needs of employees, users and learners of all ages. So again, that's a balance that's needed in there.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your indulgence, convener, and I'll have to leave the committee soon, I'm afraid. Sorry.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
Much, convener. Morning, James. Want to go back to apprenticeships that Murdo touched upon. And, you know, you've got your 12 essential pillars for success for post-school learning, and two of them relate to employers, which is great. But I noticed in your comments this morning about the skills planning, you want to take that from SDS and put it within Scottish Government. Yet we've got the Apprenticeship Approval Group, who's made up of employers who are responsible for approving all Scottish apprenticeships. We've got the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Body, who your own report says does excellent work and influence in the shape of apprenticeships. So how do we retain that employer expertise within the system if we're going to devolve it down to city regions?
To me, this is where the DYW network has a real opportunity. So SAB has done good work, really good work in helping to, A, naturalise the concept of apprenticeships, inform their development, identify the framework that should be developed. But going back to my point that I think that the very structures that were required to build our apprenticeship family, which was a dedicated focus, dedicated agency, dedicated structures. My view is that now those same structures are actually holding them back. They are keeping them separate from the rest of the learning system and the rest of the funding system. So by putting apprenticeship development into a qualification body, by putting apprenticeship funding into a funding body along with other types of learning, to me, that same principle applies to how employers shape the learning system. It can't just be about an apprenticeship group over here, separate from the rest of the system. I think that's where DYW could potentially have greater resource and focus on informing all parts of the learning system, including apprenticeships. So for me, if you were the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board and my report has suggested you'd be wound up, my message to you would be, it's partly because of the work you have done that we want to see those same principles embedded across all parts of the learning system and in all parts of the country. And I've also suggested there should be above that DYW network, which effectively, I suppose, currently is the DYW Chairs Group, that National Employers Board, that can help inform the national priorities that we were talking about earlier as well. So I see it as the opportunity to really accelerate that employer voice, not dismantle it, but particularly put apprenticeships back in the mainstream, because they're too important to be carved out separately, I think.
You mentioned the developing young workforce a lot, and I was pleased to see within the report we're having three army barracks in my constituency that you talked about the armed forces and veterans and the need for lifelong learning and retraining, etc. But much of the system that we currently have focuses on young people in positive destinations, quite rightly, to break that generational unemployment situation we'd had over a number of years. So given the state of financial situation in public funds, how do we get the balance right so that we maintain the positive destinations for young folk, but we also are able to introduce lifelong learning? In this reorganisation, do you see efficiencies that would help that?
So again, I think that's about ensuring a broad perspective on skills delivery. So what I would like to see is the Y drop from DYW. I'd like to see that actually be a developing workforce network for people of all ages. And I think that's not because, as you say, Generation Youth unemployment is not still an intransigent issue in many areas. But I think if I look back over the last 3 or 4 years at DYW and the Young Persons Guarantee, both, you know, brilliant initiatives and a brilliant focus, I think a lot of that was predicated on a post-pandemic situation, which was going to be a generation of unemployed young people, which actually hasn't come to pass. That's not been the impact of the pandemic. And I think given we are in a country with a shrinking workforce, ONS forecasts we're going to, our population is going to shrink faster in Scotland than any other part of the UK. Immigration is not going to be the answer. It's more challenging now than it was when we were in the EU. The need to, for us to tap into every shred of potential of our people is more critical than it's ever been. And I think, and I've seen a number of numbers here, but if we are in the region of 400,000 people who are economically inactive in Scotland, who could be active, so it's not long-term ill or unable to work, but who could be active, that need to have an all-age focus, I think, is one of the most critical parts of the whole future of the system.
Okay. And last point I was wanting to ask you about, again, you mentioned in your report that apprentices struggle to have their voices and opinions listened to within the system. But unless I've missed it, I've not saw how you think we should be able to address that.
Yeah, so I think I spent time in a number of colleges, and certainly apprenticeships moving through that process seemed to be well supported within the college network. I was quite taken with how that worked, and meeting them, how they felt they were able to kind of I suppose, shape their immediate short-term environment, or if you like, the course they were ongoing. The question for me is how they shape the future of that. And again, I think how you build structures in to do that is open to some question of how you actually build that. But again, if there's a DYW network working really closely, including DYW coordinators working hand in hand with careers advisors, the SDS advisors in school, in being able to work with those who are going through apprenticeships, those who have come out the back of, and those who might be going into it, then hopefully that might capture the voice. I mean, it was one of those I felt it could be strengthened. It wasn't a fundamental weakness for me in the system. There were other areas that were more flashing red lights for me than that, but I think there's definitely potential to capture their views on their experience of the system and how it could be more attractive to them as well.
Okay, thank you. I just have a question. It struck me earlier when you talked about hairdressing and engineering and forestry that they are very traditionally gendered roles, and we know for discussion about modern apprentice that there are more, it's very male dominated, the modern apprenticeship system. You talked about the need for structural reform. Do you see the structural reform you suggested in any way addressing inequalities in the system? So how can we address issues of occupational segregation, particularly in relation to gender, but also we can apply the same to disability? You'll know the committee has done a short piece of work into disability employment gap. Do you see inequalities? How do we address inequalities through the reforms that you've suggested?
Yeah, so I spent some time with a whole range of, I suppose, third sector bodies that were either advocating for gender-based reform or represent marginalised communities. There's talk about veterans reintegrating back out of military service, talking with Ima Jackson in Glasgow about migrants coming to the country, how we properly profile their skills, match them to the frameworks that we've got already. In saying that there's no single vision for what good looks like in the system, in the absence of that, I wrote my own. It was not perfect, but my view was that every individual in Scotland has equitable opportunity to access the learning they need to thrive. So for me, that equity bit is built right in the heart of it. I do think, again, you can't be what you can't see comes back to that need for really state-of-the-art careers advice and provision in schools. And I think some of my experience in talking to groups was that some of that gender bias or unconscious bias or reality in some occupations was ingrained at a really, really early stage. So how we talk about the opportunities, I think, will be important going forward. I've also seen, post my review, some pretty amazing ed tech platforms that are being built. There's one called Global Bridge, there's one called Skills Miner that are matching people's skills and potential to jobs that are on offer in a way that is fueled by AI that is completely anonymous on issues of gender, race, background, age, all of that, which is a really interesting, you know, potential way of doing it. And I suppose if there is unconscious bias, certainly sitting within any part of the employer community, getting around some of that. So I think some of that, that ed tech investment could be really valuable.
Okay, thank you very much. That brings us to the end of today's evidence session. I'd like to thank James Withers for his attendance at committee this morning. I'll now suspend the meeting and we'll move into private session.